Chairman, sir, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for inviting me here and for listening to me. I hope that I am of some use to you. My topic is slightly different to what has been discussed so far. It is raising inspiring leaders and citizens of tomorrow. A year ago, I was in China at the house of Jack Ma, founder of Alibaba. So he and I were discussing education, which, as you probably know, was his first profession and still remains his passion. And he told me that he was going to be starting a business school and that he was going to be teaching entrepreneurship. He then asked me, he said, what would you like to teach? So I said, I will be teaching leadership. So he started laughing. He said, you can't teach leadership. Either someone has it or doesn't have it. When he realized that I was quite serious about it, then we had a longer discussion on how to teach leadership. In fact, what I told him was rather cheeky of me. I said, we'll do one thing. You prepare the entrepreneurs, then you send them to me and I'll make leaders out of them. which was, he's of course one of the biggest entrepreneurs the world has seen, and considering that he started from scratch, he's built himself something to be quite proud of. I have been in the field of education for over 40 years, half as a teacher and half as a principal, and a little bit in between as Secretary of Education in the Government of Punjab. So you get from me a slightly holistic view of what I feel is possible or not. But I'm going to handle this talk slightly differently so that most of you here who are principals are actually going to have some takeaway from it. The first example I'm going to give you is of what happened in 1935. It happened in two parts of the world. It happened in Scotland, and it happened in Dehradun, in India. There's a gentleman called Kurt Hahn, who is a German Jew, and he was targeted by Hitler because he used to speak at morning assembly in his school, Zalim, which is one of the most well-known schools in Germany today, about democracy and speak against fascism. So he was jailed, and some of his old students, who included Prince Philip, who's married to Queen Elizabeth, and the King of Greece, they put pressure on Clement Attlee, who was the Prime Minister in England, and had him deported from Germany to the UK, where he set up a school in Scotland called Gordonston. At the same time, in 1935, a school opened in Dehradun, and a lot of similarities between the two. Kurt Hahn was a visionary. He started four different movements, some of which you must be familiar with. He started the Round Square group of schools. He started the United World Colleges. He started the Outward Bound movement. And he started what in some countries we call the Duke of Edinburgh Award Scheme, and in some countries we call the, what's it? Oh, yeah, International Award for Young People. So, I mean, that's a lot for one man to have done. On this side, and shuttling between the two was a gentleman called John Martin, who happened to be my first English teacher and then later my, and also my first headmaster. And so we managed to get this very good cross-referencing of what was happening there and here. And what was the context of the Doon School opening? Yeah, I forgot, I have to press some things here. I forgot all about that. Huh? This and this, not up and down. No. Okay. Now, this is a picture of the Daly College, where I was principal for 14 years. And it is the oldest of the chief's colleges. There were five chief's colleges in India meant for the sons of princes. This was the, what is RAMC? At that time, it was the Royal Indian Military College. Now it is the Rashtriya Indian Military College in Dehradun. And you have the Lawrence School, Lovedale here. But what I'm trying to say is that the schools in India were something quite new. The old magical system we had in ancient times, where we had 30,000 students from 30 nationalities studying in the best liberal arts and science universities in the world, those days had long gone by. They had been dismantled. And by the time 1935 comes around, it was very much the British creation of schools, which was aimed at producing lower and middle level civil servants for the railways and other services, because that's what they required from the local population. There were the Christian missionary schools, there were Hindu schools, Muslim schools, the madrasas, there was a school for the railways, so as I showed you, for the military, for the princes, but there was no real merit-based school. The British decided to introduce liberal arts in the Americas. And what was the result? The result was the American War of Independence. Because the Americans realized, from all the political theory and philosophy that they studied of the British thinkers, the French thinkers, that they were being taken for a ride. They were being denied the right of self-determination, of self-governance, and so on. And so the British decided that they are not going to allow liberal arts to come into India. Keep it very simple. And till today, unfortunately, the choices in schools, in most schools, are very limited. There is the science stream, either with biology or with physics, and there is the commerce stream. Some schools have humanities, and the rest don't. Whereas we could give the children an option of 22 or 30 choices, we give them two or three, and then we wonder why they are not creative. Anyway, liberal education, or at the school level, what we can talk of as humanities, is something which has not been allowed to develop outside the British Isles. It started developing in the US. Of course, in Europe, it's there. But China, Singapore, Korea have only discovered its value recently. And China has, in fact, a society which believed almost entirely in science and math, has acknowledged that the future lies in the humanities and in liberal arts. I'm going to give you some examples of the thinking people have with regard to this. The first example I'm going to give you is of myself. I was a student having to make my decision of what I wanted to do by way of subject choices. I had no doubt in my mind what I wanted to do, so I selected humanities. My school refused. They said, "You can't do humanities. You will do science." I said, "I can't stand science. I love history. I love literature. I want to do humanities. I don't want to do science." no, you can't do humanities because you're fairly intelligent. And if you're fairly intelligent, you have to do science. My father was posted in Chennai. He had to come all the way to Dehradun to persuade the school to let me make my own mistake. And so I was allowed to do humanities. The second example that I'll give you is in the mid, about 1985, 86. So 84, 85, I can't remember. I received an offer to become the chairman of CBSC, and I went to the office to see what this organization was all about. And I actually, and you may not believe me, but I actually found a note which was headed saying, not to be shown to Sumer Singh. So obviously I read it. And it was the most horrifying thing that I could have imagined. From the chairperson of CBSC was this note which said to examiners who were examining class 10 and class 12, mainly class 12 papers, that when you're marking science and math, you can give up to 100%. When you're marking humanities and languages, do not exceed 70%. I was really horrified, so I went running to the Secretary of Education, Anil Bodia, at that time. And I said, Anil, what is this? He said, my goodness, horrific. Let's go and see the minister. So we went to Arjun Singh Ji's room. And Arjun Singh Ji never talked. He used to only look at you. So he sat there, he looked at this note, he looked at us, and he rang the bell, picked up the phone, did whatever he had to do, and the next thing we knew was that the chairperson was in the room. So he asked the chairperson, he said, what is this? She said, sir, it's nothing much. You know and I know that all those people who are intelligent, they do science. And those who can't do science do humanities. So it's perfectly fair. So Arjun Singh was quiet for a moment. Then he turned to me and he said, Sumer, what did you do in college? I said, history, sir. He turned to Anil Bodia and he said, what did you do, Anil? He said, history, sir. He said, funnily enough, I also did history. You know, I mean, the three of us, what are we doing here? So this poor chairperson immediately withdrew that notice and issued another notice. But that's the mindset. Then came 2003. I went as a head in Madhya Pradesh. And I found that not a single school in Madhya Pradesh had humanities. Not one. And when I introduced humanities, my staff told me, don't be silly, no one's going to take it. And sure enough, for 2 years, no one took it until I realized my staff was telling them not to take it. And today, it is the most difficult, most sought after combination that they can get. But in this whole scenario, there were a handful, I'm now getting to the part of my speech which I'm supposed to be talking about. There were a handful of people, Indians and British, who saw that independence was coming. That the country would suddenly find itself without leaders in industry, in commerce, in the army, in politics, in law, they'd all be gone because it was all the Brits. So these people had all studied in England. That was the difference. They knew what they were going to be doing. And they decided to start in India a school which would be merit-based and have a whole lot of other things which they would take from good education. And this experiment was the Doon School in Dehradun. It was an experiment. It was a very brave experiment for reasons I will give you just now. First of all, declared policy of the school was it is secular. The Muslim, the Christian, the Hindu, and other religious students would all live together, totally residential school. They would sit at the same dining table and eat together, including the vegetarians and non-vegetarians. They would all have to work, do social service, community service, in the house of Dalits. And they would have to work in a Dalit village also and go for every relief operation anywhere in the country where there was a disaster. So my grandfather told me, he said that I had strict instructions from the headmaster not to tell my wife what your father was up to, because otherwise he would have been withdrawn. He was accorded no privileges. He had to do exactly what Mr. Foote, the first headmaster, felt every human being should be sensitized to. Foote went around the whole country and he collected students wherever he went. So it was actually the first school where there were literally students from every part of the country, because he wanted a mini India to be developed there. There was complete equality for all students. Now that may sound quite normal in today's context, but it was not normal. In the Christian missionary schools, the Christians were of a higher status than the non-Christians. In the chief's colleges, they did not allow a non-prince to join. And they sat at their dining tables according to the status of the state, not according to the age of the child or the class of the child. So here was going to be the first school with total equality. No money allowed, no expensive watches or gadgets allowed. Everyone would wear the same uniform. No outings allowed except on certain days, very strict. And who were the people who joined? The Maharaja of Kashmir sent his son. The Maharaja of Jaipur sent his son. In fact, the chief's colleges lost their best clients who decided to go and join this new experiment, because they felt that, wow, if we can bring our kids up in a normal way, what an advantage it'll be to them when they grow up. The assembly prayer book, if you see, which is there till today, is totally non-denominational. If one religion is mentioned, all of them are mentioned. The cultural influence was very strong of Rabindranath Tagore, because the headmaster had with him an assistant whose job was to make sure that there would be a strong Indian culture in the school. So the art teacher, the music teacher had come from Shantiniketan. And all together, it was very different to what most people imagine happens in the Doon School. In the evenings, we wore our kurta pajamas or any other dhoti or anything that we wanted to from the Indian cultural background. They decided compulsory adventure activity, which is what Kurt Hahn decided in Scotland, that unless you push yourself and you take calculated risks, you will never know how much potential you have. So adventure activity became compulsory. If you read the book of Indian mountaineering and the Everest expeditions and Kanchenjunga and so on, more than half the climbers are from Doon. A liberal curriculum. compulsory games, compulsory spare time cultural activities through societies and clubs. A weekly student publication which started in 1935 and goes on till today, produced by the students. I know I got into trouble once because one of the cooks wrote an article and I didn't look at it. And the editor that year was Sardi Rajan, a South Indian who didn't read the Hindi part of it. The Hindi editor was in hospital. And the next thing I knew was I got a notice from Parliament summoning me and the editor, who was a student, because that person had signed himself off as terrorist and had endorsed the assassination of Indira Gandhi. So I know what I went through, but the students were running the paper. When I was a student, we ran an underground newspaper called the Suppressed Echo. But we never wrote against anyone individually. And we were all the house captains. And the principal, poor guy, used to keep calling us and saying, find out who's behind it. And he used to say, we will try our best. Compulsory hobbies, as I said. Now, decisions on much that concerned the students were taken by elected students in committees, both at the junior and senior levels. The prefects, captains, society secretaries, editors were trained. They were not just appointed or elected, they were trained. And they were trained in etiquette, in responsibility of leadership, and most significantly, corporal punishment was absolutely prohibited right from the day the school started. The rule which was issued was, if a student reports that a master has hit a child, the master will have to leave the school within 24 hours. And I myself have had to implement these things at times, very strictly followed. So the headmaster, Foot, he got a letter from the principal of King George's Military College saying, you're crazy. You can't control 400 kids, boys of this age without corporal punishment. You're going to have a major disciplinary problem. And I read the letter, because I wrote the history of Doon School, so I researched it. I read the letter which Foot wrote back. He thanked him for his concern, and he told him, he said, there is a difference between what you are doing and what I am doing. Your job is to prepare military officers who are going to obey orders and issue orders. My job is to prepare the independent leaders of a free India. I cannot have corporal punishment in the school, because the minute I have it, I cannot have self-discipline. I will have imposed discipline. And I'm hoping there will be no one to impose discipline on these boys when they grow up. They must have self-discipline so that they can achieve whatever they do without others having to tell them that you must work, you must do this, you must do that. So, you know, this was absolutely a different kind of a schooling that was brought in. And the school song was in two verses. The first verse of the school song was made into India's national anthem. So the school doesn't have a song now. Did this experiment succeed? You see, if you take, I've again forgotten to do all this. This is the Doon School. This is some poor kid being beaten up. These are some of the, you know, old Doon School products. There's the Maharaja of Jaipur. There's the Maharaja of Kashmir. There's Pilu Modi, who was a great rebel who used to go to parliament with a badge saying, I am a CIA agent. There's Dinesh Singh, whom he got into serious trouble. Dinesh Singh used to be the industries minister. And Mrs. Gandhi was the prime minister. She was a very, very suspicious woman. So when she was walking past in the central hall of parliament, Pilu Modi whispered to Dinesh Singh, he said, Khus, pus, khus, pus. And Mrs. Gandhi did not speak to Dinesh Singh for months. And this was the way they used to, you know, and this gentleman, Miangul Aurangzeb, was the last ruler of Swat, and he became the governor of Punjab. Here is Jilani Khan, also the governor of Punjab. I'm talking about Pakistan-Punjab. These are the two Punjab, Pakistani-Punjab governors. This is George Verghese, some of you may remember, Magsaysay Award winner. Now I've jumped more than I should have. Okay. So now the civil services, commerce, both in India and Pakistan, were filled with boys from Doon. There were 350 boys at that time in the school. So you can imagine how many passed out. Already, you know, there were so many of the people who would normally have gone to the chief's colleges who were joining here that the chief's colleges then decided to convert themselves into public schools and throw open their doors onto to students on the basis of merit. Now, were these boys exceptional? Did they become leaders because they had some great inherent talent? I don't think so. I seriously don't think so. And this is where we get to the crux of this whole talk. These boys became successful, whatever your definition of successful may be, because the school believed in them. The school gave them opportunity to take on responsibility, to self-discipline themselves, and to grow. Now, this list included five Indians and one Pakistani foreign secretaries. Any number of secretaries in the government of India. Two governors of Pakistan, cabinet ministers and generals on both sides of the border, journalists, chairmen of multinationals in India and Pakistan, entrepreneurs, doctors, architects, and so on. Do I have time to give you one very interesting story that took place? Just to show you how the camaraderie developed between these kids. When I was writing the history of Doon School, I got a letter from the Wali of Swat in Pakistan, in fact from his younger brother, saying that I'm attaching a very interesting story which you may like to publish in the book. The story was that he was part of the Rangers who invaded Kashmir. He was commanding that unit. And in that raid, they took a prisoner. And the prisoner was the son of the Diwan of Kashmir, the Prime Minister of Kashmir's son. And he tells the Prime Minister's son, he says, I'm very sorry, but we have to move on and we cannot carry prisoners with us. So we will be shooting you tomorrow. So this guy turns around and tells him, come on, we've been roommates for 6 years. They were both in the same room, in the same house for 6 years. He said, I'm very sorry, but there's nothing I can do. I can make one concession for you. When you go for your bath in the morning, they used to have those three side, you know, cloths, and you went for your bath. if you make a run for it, I will try and distract my men and hopefully you will get away. So he said, come on, don't be funny, because you know that you send us for a bath without, you send me for a bath without a towel. He said, well, that's your choice. You want to be modest, you be modest. You want to escape, make an attempt. And so this man ran. Now it had all been planned. His men knew that the commander was allowing this prisoner to escape because he was an old school friend. Now I thought it was only fair to send a copy of this letter to the gentleman who had run. So I sent him a letter. I said, I'm publishing this before I publish it. Do you have any comments? He arrived in Dehradun from Calcutta. He was Tribeni Tissues, a big multinational company. He said, Sumer, I have grandchildren. What are you going? I said, is it true? He said, of course it's true, but you can't publish this. I said, okay, fine, I won't publish it. But I just wanted your permission and you're not giving it, so I won't publish it. Now, this kind of camaraderie which developed did not happen on its own either. And this is again something that I would like you principals to consider. The first headmaster and the second headmaster took great pains to start an old students' society. And they used to go during the vacations to all different parts of India and meet them. They used to invite them to their homes in England once they retired, if they happened to be there. And they published a book. And if you see the old boys' register of the Doon School, it not only gives the name of the child, it gives the name of any relative who studied there. It gives the name of his wife and mentions whether she is a relative of anyone who studied there. It gives his anniversary. It gives his hobbies. It gives everything about the person. And it is all there in the central office in Delhi. So if I am traveling, let's say to Europe, three different countries, I write to my old Students Association office and I say I'm going to these three countries, they will send me immediately the names, the addresses, the telephone numbers, the email addresses, the professions of all these people who are in that area. If I'm looking for a job, I have to only write to them. They will send me a full list of all people in that profession who are capable of organizing an interview. The kind of after-school networking that takes place is something you should never neglect, because these are your biggest assets. When you eat a chocolate, madam, which is your favorite chocolate? Do you eat chocolate or you don't eat chocolate?
Yeah, Cadbury.
Cadbury. You've been to the factory? No? Okay. But you still like Cadbury, even though you haven't been to the factory. And that is the same with the school. You don't have to go to the school building to like the product. Eventually, it is not the campus, it is not the building that matters. It is the product. And when people turn around and look at someone and say, wow, that's an impressive person. I wonder which school he went to. And you hear your school's name being mentioned. The satisfaction that you get is something amazing. And those kids want their children to study there. I had an old student from Lawrence School, Sanaa, where I was the headmaster. He brought his wife. They had just had a baby. And he was trying to persuade her to register the baby in Lawrence School, Sanaa. And she was not agreeing. So finally they came to see me. And he tells me, he says, explain to her. I'm trying to tell her that whatever I am is because of this school. And she said, I rest my case. I have nothing further to say. So I told him, you go and fight your own battle. Don't get me involved in this. I personally seriously believe that a school can make leaders by taking into consideration every aspect of the growth of the individual. And that is why I like your motto, your tagline, where every child matters. It is where every child matters. When you don't talk about class 11B, but you talk about the individual children in class 11B, that is when the difference comes. Follow up with your kids after they leave school. That is very, very important. They are your biggest assets, and they are your biggest resource for the future. I'm not talking about money. I'm talking about in expertise, in advertising your school, in so many different aspects. I believe, as was said in my introduction, that education is nothing but a series of experiences, and it is the job of the parents and the school to provide the opportunities for those experiences. Everyone is not going to learn the same from the same experience, but everyone will benefit some way or the other. Our job is to provide those opportunities. How much they learn from it, we can try and help them along the way, but we have to provide those opportunities. Now, I am asked sometimes that you are lucky you went to Doon and Stephens, and you must be very happy with that kind of education. It's not Doon and Stephens which made me what I am. My two biggest experiences which make me whatever I am today, the first is that I had to leave home when I was in doing my MA, because I told my parents, and I had been telling them since class 9, that I'm going to become a school teacher. And finally, my father had enough, my parents had enough, and they said, if you're serious about becoming a school teacher, put your checkbook and your car keys on the table, sign a check, and walk out of the house, and don't come back. And that's what happened. That's what I did. And then we never made up. It never happened. But I don't regret that decision, because it put me through almost 2 months of absolute poverty. I used to eat one piece of bread in Calcutta, what they call pav, in the morning and one in the evening. That was it. I couldn't afford anything. My second experience, apart from going through that hardship, was 1 year I spent in my village. And I realized that what the hell have I been doing? This is what I need to understand. And I'll give you another example here, which might, but I can't go to jail now. What happened was that I had no money, and there was some land which was being taken away. So I went to see somebody in the police, and he said, do you have money? I said, no. Do you have political power? I said, no. He said, if you have no money, no political power, go home, go away. You can't keep this land. In Punjab, without money and political backing, you are not going to be able to retain any land. So I said, okay, I'll become a politician. He said, if you can do that, you're okay. So I stood for election for 102 villages, and I became the president. I was underage by 3 years. I shouldn't have actually been allowed to stand. But what opened my eyes was, I don't know whether any of you are familiar with the Cooperative Marketing Society election. Half the directors are chosen by each village, that's 102 votes, and the other directors are chosen by individual voting. Now, in the number of village votes that we had, my group had, because I formed a group quickly, I had been in the village only 10 days, we found that we were going to have, out of 102, we were sure of about 40. And we were sure that the other side had about 70, 30. So 70 were taken care of. What about the other 32? So I said, we must go and talk to them. So my supporter said, don't be funny, you are now in the Punjab, you don't go and talk to people. I said, then what do you do? They said, kidnap them. So I said, are you serious? They said, yes. So these guys were all kidnapped, some by the other side, some by this side. And they were taken off into different Simla and so on and all, given liquor, chicken, taken care of. On the day of voting, I asked my guys, I said, how are we going to know that the guy's actually going to vote for us? They all declared that they had eye problem. They needed a helper to vote, cast their vote. And the same helper saw everyone through. And I realized, I said, what have I been teaching my children? Civics. About democracy, about the right to this and the right to that. Where is it existing? We have a long way to go. We are on the right track, but we have not yet reached there. My second example, which I would like to give on leadership, is I was attending a conference in Singapore, and it was a conference on special ability children, on what they call gifted children. Now, my mind went to children who have some kind of a learning difficulty, and they were going to be telling us how to deal with these situations. No, not at all. They were not interested in that aspect of education at all. Their gifted children were people who were really bright, very bright. They were made to work 17 hours a day. This was at the best school in Singapore. And they were all promised, you're going to be great, you're going to be famous, you're going to be rich, you're going to be... And they said, now we want you to come and address the conference the next time it's being held in China. And I said, I don't think you want me to come and address this conference because I will speak against the topic. So they said, why? And I said, you will not understand what I mean, but you just leave me out of it. And this is the reason what I had in my mind. You have two people here. Spider-Man and the Joker. Now, both are highly intelligent people. It's difficult to say who's more intelligent. But one of them has values and the other one doesn't. One of them has empathy, he feels for other people. The other one doesn't. Totally selfish. And what I could see they were producing in these gifted children were totally selfish people who had never done a day of community service. And this is very important, that leadership is not just to reach a certain level in your profession, but to feel for the people whom you are leading. So values have to be taught. Values have to be inculcated. Very important. Everyone has different ways of doing it. Whatever you choose to do, you must make sure that there is no child who comes out of your school without a sense of value and community service, without a sense of empathy, without a sense of environmental sustainability, without a sense of basically doing the right thing. And that is what makes the difference. I will give you a definition of leadership, just to clarify it further. There is the lowest kind of leader is someone who is sitting in the chair of the leader. Because he or she is sitting in that chair, people bow to the person. They're not bowing to the person, they're bowing to the chair, but sometimes we forget that we are only in a particular role for a transient period, we begin to think that we are something special. And the next level of leader is someone who not only sits in that chair, but who is a good person. You can say, he's a nice guy, he's nice to us. The third level is someone who is sitting in that chair, is nice to us, and is moving the organization along in the right way. The fourth is someone who is also benefiting us in terms of our growth potential. But the ultimate leader is someone who is able to create leaders all around and who makes a qualitative difference in the lives of everyone whom he is responsible for. This is the test. If I am the leader, are the people in my organization or the people who are dependent on me benefited in the quality of their life? Secondly, are those people who are around me getting the opportunity to actually become leaders themselves? Am I delegating to them? Am I allowing them to grow? Or am I so worried that they may become better than me and I may be exposed that I don't give an opportunity to anyone else? So this is something you need to look at as far as this is concerned. Is my time over? Yeah? 5 minutes? Oh, that's a lot of time. Thank you. So, let me go to the next one. A student must learn to take responsibility for his own actions. He must learn to work as a team, as part of a team, which is not easy, huh? What happens? We spend all our time in fierce competition against each other. And then finally you are told, you guys are a team, work together. Where are you going to work together? So you have to actually work this out properly. Don't go and mess it up. Sensitive to intercultural issues, to environmental sustainability, to gender sensitivity, to be secular, democratic, to agree to disagree. Very important. Person should not get into arguments unnecessarily. I can't change your mind. Why am I getting into an argument? How does it matter to me if I can convince you that I'm right? It is better to say, okay, let's agree to disagree. You have your point of view, I have my point of view. Now, it's some sense of adventure, sense of humor. Very, very important sense of humor. To respect culture and heritage. And what the Dalai Lama says, this is my simple religion. There is no need for temples, no need for complicated philosophy. Our own brain, our own heart is our temple. The philosophy is kindness. Okay, I think I'll just skip the last bit and just say this. Happiness isn't getting all you want. It's enjoying all that you have. And as John Dewey so aptly put it, if we teach today's students as we taught yesterday's, we rob them of tomorrow. And finally, and this is the last sentence, and I'll close, I promise you, that do not have transactional schools. This is not a business. Have transformational schools. Transactional schools is what is killing our children. Have transformational schools. Transform them into better human beings. Thank you.